Welcome back, everybody, here to our wonderful broadcast of the Gigabyte Challenge. I'm Toby One. I'm also getting the same thing. Yeah, okay, there we go. That's audio. Hey, we both check our plugs. Hey, we're here for the grand final time for the Gigabyte Challenge. Finally, we have arrived. We are looking to climb to the tallest mountain of the tallest cliff of the tallest of everything because we just like tall things.
Only the best Dota here.
Exactly.
The Gigabyte Challenge.
Exactly. Let's get into the game, man, because it's already underway. So we'll have KG going up against X Game KC. So we have the Ukrainians going up against the boys from Kazakhstan. It's only a hop, skip, and a plane right away. And now we're going to get into it with your favorite hero, Cap.
Yeah.
Your favorite hero out of all the heroes that would make you gush like a Tidehunter. Razor is the man to do so.
Yeah, Razor.
Sarcasm inserted.
Still, after TI4, you would expect it, like something else to show up, you know,
yeah,
to start experimenting. Yeah. But they watch TI4 and
you'd expect like a changelog to show up.
That's true. You would expect a certain hero to have made it into the game by now.
You just sit there. You
Valve.
Could you imagine all the beta testers just sitting there at TI4 during the grand final? And they're all just like, yeah, Valve brought us all here so we can enjoy the game. And oh, crap, the entire world is going to be hating on us at the end of this grand final. It's the only thing going through their head. It's like having, like, imagine if America beat Germany. Like, we warned you about that. Like, if America ever beat Germany in the World Cup, you would never speak English,
especially
with an American accent, anywhere in Germany, or else you get killed. And I'm just wondering, if there's beta tester written on their little access pass, like, if they would just get murdered. I'm just saying.
What it comes down to... What it really comes down to
is Cap.
Valve.
Yes, Cap.
Where the hell is Techies?
That's a very good question.
That is a really good question. Where is Techies?
I'm sorry.
You promised it after TI. Come on. Some BS, man. Valve, you're on my shit list right now.
Radiant team pick.
I have been waiting for that hero for so long, and it was such a mockery when they put it into the TI2 list.
Yeah?
Such a mockery.
I know, man.
It's disgusting. All right, we're going to see an Earthshaker. Death Prophet comp is gaming, going for something similar that we've seen in the past. So, once again, picking up the long-range initiator, followed up by the Death Prophet pushing. One thing that was actually pretty clever of them, when they went for some of those pushes, I don't know if you noticed it, when they went for like one of the mid lane pushes and they took they really quickly like took the rags, backed out, and the Earthshaker immediately closed off any attempt at a pursuit with the Fissure block off.
Yep.
And Tidehunter blinked on the other side, and he was like, I can ravage, but there's no one else who's going to be able to follow. What do I do?
Uh-huh.
So, Compass Gaming
has displayed... It was divide and conquer, really.
Yeah. They've displayed... Some good strength in the past with this combo.
They're definitely their team fights is something to go. Well done. I'm just hoping we get to see their sniper again because at the late game it really did like evaporate the Razor. And they're in the same position again. They're up against the Razor. This time though, they're not facing up against the Wombo combo, the Death Prophet, as well as the Razor. So they've at least managed to separate these two apart. Remaining. But they got Mass Serpent Wards now, which also helped them breach high ground. Radiant and who knows what other potential fighting will be coming out here from X Game.
Banning away the Centaur once again. So Centaur being a strong, I suppose, any melee initiator. So maybe the Clockwork as well as the Centaur.
Because the last game you were talking about it, saying like the Centaur would have been a really great pickup because it would counter the Razor pick they had. But now the Centaur is being banned out against
the
team who already has the Razor.
It was for the Brewmaster.
Okay, yeah, that's right.
It's a really good counter to the Brewmaster. It's not bad versus the Razor either in that regard. But I think in general, they're probably looking at it. Either they just hate Centaur, or melee initiators in general are strong versus Death Prophet. Any hero that can get up in that Death Prophet's face and lay down some serious nuking damage is going to be an issue. So maybe the Clockwork is going to be banned out here. Yep, sure enough.
There he goes.
Their fourth ban.
Yeah, ripping it out. Reminder to everyone who's tuning in, this is a best of three. This is not a best of one like the rest of the Gigabyte Challenge. Well, obviously we have €2,000 on the line. And these teams, they got to play hardball for it. Mm-hmm. So best of three coming your way right now. We'll stick with you until the bitter end, myself and Cap. And remember, tomorrow morning, I say tomorrow morning for the Europeans. If you're tuning in from America, it'll be really late at night. And if you're tuning in as well from... Actually, it's not really that late. Actually, yeah, it's really it's early in the morning from America.
It's early morning. It's
15 CEST tomorrow. So late at night for Europe, for China, actually. Yeah, we have Scythe versus Arrow going on. So 3 p.m. tomorrow, the Join Data League Asia Season 2 is on. And if you want to, you can also go in to the in-game store. The Join Data League ticket got released today. So it's available for purchase. So if you want to please support anything Join Dota, you can do so by buying that ticket. You could also... like subscribe to our Twitch channel here. We've got more action coming up for you as well. The next season of ESL's qualifiers will be coming up shortly. We have some other things which we might be also doing over on our Twitch live stream. We have the Chinese matches, iGames, as well as WEC will also be over on this live stream. And I believe we have one major event which is yet to be announced, which will be here on the live stream. So all around,
it's that
it's so much gaming.
It's that time of the year, Toby.
It is.
Remember, what was it, February? Where we're like, there's a lot to be announced, guys. A lot to be announced. And it just kept on.
And it kept coming out. And then, okay, then everything lulled down until like TI4. And now we're going to be like, everything's coming back again. And
So right now is announcement season.
Yes.
A month from now, it's going to be full on Toby and I constantly casting because we've announced so many things we're going to be casting.
It's going to be death is what it's going to be, man. If one of us gets sick, we are so totally screwed. Melk will now be taking over as play-by-play, guys. Milk.
I'd like to hear some Milk play-by-play. Bring in PyCat.
We already heard it from PyCat. It's pretty placid, actually. It's really placid. Look at us as a Slark. First time we get to see this hero in the game tonight. So, interesting to see the type of build we also see from the Slark. We're seeing Shadowblade builds, but the most popular one of late when you get some early aggression is a Blink Dagger. But how a Blink Dagger Slark will work up against a Razor, a Batrider, or a Shadow Shaman, that I'm not so sure about. There's a lot of controlling abilities against him.
Slark is good in this regard. He's good versus the Batrider. He's decently strong versus the Razor. So, I don't know. For me, at first, it was a peculiar pickup, but now that I look at it, Slark's pretty decent against what X game, the cores that they have. Shadow Shaman is still going to be a big threat, especially if you're able to get a Blink Dagger. You know, getting hexed up and you don't have Dark Pact already activated and about ready to go off is going to be a killer. So, he certainly has to play careful around many of these disables, but at the same time, the Batrider and the Razor are both... pretty weak against the Slark in general, so I like what I like to pick up so far. This also gives them some decent late game, so once again, we're not going to be seeing the Death Prophet go for an all-in five-man push at 20 minutes in and try and end the game by 30. Slark certainly does have much better carry potential than any of the heroes on X games so far.
You think Compass isn't going to go for a push early on?
Well, I think they're going to go for like normal tier 1 tower pushes and maybe even a tier 2 once they have Death Prophet at level 11. But I'm saying that they don't have to end the game by 35 minutes.
Yeah.
You know, it's not one of those push strats where it's like...
Because I'm wondering if they just go all in on this one. If they grab something like a Pugna with the Enchantress and the Earthshaker, force out a lot of pressure, leave that Slark on the offlane... and then put the Death Prophet in towards the mid.
I would be too scared to do that up against the Batrider Razor. The Enigma gives actually more incentive for you to do that because Enigma is not very strong against those kind of heavy pushes. It's very, very greedy so far, and yeah, that's an interesting plan.
That flags Storm Spirit pick for me. Sorry, straight away.
Well, Bloodseeker is the ultimate counter versus Slark, right?
Yeah, true, so. True. Like, it's the never-ending, even if you have BKB. Yeah, it sounds. You're right. But I'm still flagging, like, where are they going to have... Because that's one thing which Compass doesn't have. They don't have... Like, unless it's Slark jumping in, their initiation is actually quite weak. Now, jumping in Slark into Enigma and everything else which is there, it could really spell doom out for him. Dark Pact's only going to protect you to a certain point. And then Enigma Black Hole, that's the controller which X Games is looking for, considering they have no extra silence, and Dark Pact will always cause them problems with every other ability.
Do you think because the Enigma has picked up Black Hole being so strong versus the Slark, they walk themselves away from the Slark one position and put him as the offlane and pick up a different carry?
That was going to be my thought process here. Weaver can still certainly be an offlane hero, but I think this is more likely we're going to see a Slark offlane, and Weaver is now going to be a one position.
You could run a Weaver offlane, but only if you know 100% that Raze is going to be on the safe lane.
Yeah, and you're dealing with a Shadow Shaman.
It's going to be there anyway. Actually, no, because you got mid lane, you got Batrider offlane, so you need to see the mid lane. You need the last hero of X game before you can decide.
Yeah, what it comes down to, I think, is that the Weaver, you can run a Weaver offlane, but not up against it. I think it's used to exploit when the supports don't have very many disables, and Shadow Shaman is the ultimate disable in the laning phase. So I'm less likely to back a Weaver offlane up against a Shadow Shaman. Faceless Void now being grabbed, and he's a great hero versus Slark. He's got the only ability that reveals Slark inside of his ultimate, and is also very strong lockdown versus the Weaver as well. So you've got plenty of initiation here. X Game have a bit of a greedy lineup when it comes to the laning phase. Compass Gaming have a lot more synergy in the first 20 minutes, basically making the transition from Enchantress, allowing them to take a couple of tier 1s into the Death Prophet, getting level 11. They can start taking another tier 1, maybe even a couple of tier 2s. And the whole entire time, the Weaver's just going to be farming. It's a very straightforward plan. X Game, they do have great team fight and great counter heroes, but the synergy together is not as strong.
Yep. I can agree with that one, man. But let's run our lanes out. It looks like KPG, they're going to be doing the standard kind of thing when you move out into the enemy jungle. And sorry, I'm getting some weird click boxes. I cannot click the Enchantress or the Earthshaker.
You are totally locked on the Slark.
Yeah.
Is one of your buttons stuck? It's weird.
Yeah, I might have to disconnect and reconnect back out again. We'll watch for the fight to start with. Now I'm on the Enchantress. Our DC and Reese after this one. But the team fight's about to begin. Yeah, I can't even click on, like, Volvo, please fix. Jump's about to come in, and now fish up. Now double stun, and with the leech over towards the Wraith, they must hold him in position. The Firefly's going at the top of him. The Slark's really low in life, but he will go down. But the Razor already took the first fall, so they've got the first one out from this one. Reed has gone a long way east, and it looks like the rest of the Dire Side are following him down here. Crypt Swarm might be enough, but it's going to be Gorik right behind him.
Oh, there's your attack.
There's a three-man fissure, and there's not really a lot of space to get out of this one. The Batrider is low on life. Can they get close enough to keep the damage coming out? The Weaver trying to chase him down for the moment, cannot reach him, and looks like KPG will have to back themselves up.
Very successful smoke gank there from KPG, getting 2 kills for 1, and they also secured the first blood in time.
I'm doing it now, people, so relax.
So all in all,
Volvo, please fix spectator mode.
Well done.
Didn't you
KPG
patch this?
It is going to be a Weaver offlane, by the way. So we may see, actually, this is odd. Enchantress is staying in the jungle so far. She's gonna be trying to mess up the
There's something completely bugged with my screen. It's actually switching me back. I don't even know how you're supposed to deal with that. All right, cool. So, Cap, you gotta tell me cooldowns and everything.
Yeah.
And skill builds, because
get to look at.
I'm clicking an Enchantress and I get a Death Prophet. I don't understand what's happening right now. I double click a hero and I actually don't go there.
So Enchantress is doing something interesting here. They're gonna be running dual lanes, and the Enchantress is going to be helping the Weaver get to probably level 3 or 4, but also be interrupting the pull and maybe even messing up the Enigma a bit. So Enchantress actually got a very lackluster creep in the beginning. The Mind Stealer is really good for being able to stop certain heroes and burn out all their mana, but in this one situation, I don't think it's going to be that much of a threat.
I actually want to close Dota and reopen it, man. Right now, I'm getting really frustrated with this. I got to, or else everyone's going to be, like, livid watching this live stream.
I don't think anything is going to happen here. They are actually trying to surround the Enchantress, and they're going to be able to go for it, but they don't have any disables because Reeves has already lost all his mana.
Yep.
The follow-up slow, goddamn, trying to get away. The right clicks are doing a bunch of work, but no bash is going to come out from Mantis, and that means goddamn will walk away with about 15 health. Meanwhile, top lane, we have the Batriders fighting up against the him. It's unlikely for you ever to get enough sticky napalm charges on a Slark because of Dark Pact, but as I say that, he actually has no levels of Dark Pact up against a Batrider. Hmm. I'm not sure if I agree with this. You would expect at least by level 3 to have a 1-1-1 build. But he actually went for a second level right. into Pounce.
We're doing this now. Everyone, picnic.
Oh, I thought you were already doing it.
Oh, no, no.
That's why I was calling the action.
I wasn't, because the action was happening, so I didn't get out. So, it's like...
Mantis is spending so much time forcing this Enchantress out.
Small patch. Enchantress is now going to die, in fact, while up on top lane. As I'm casting off Cavalus's Greed, the Batrider goes up against the Slark. Firefly away, but Faceless Voice brought down the Enchantress on the bottom rune.
Odd. Odd that Faceless Void is committing so much time to hunt down the Enchantress, and even odder still that he actually successfully got the kill.
Well, everyone, breathe in and enjoy Danny Dim's
Windranger.
Lirale.
Whatever the hell her name is.
Yeah. You tried doing a voiceover for that one.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
You good now, Toby? You good?
No.
The hell?
Actually, no. Legitimately, things are broken. Volvo, what did you break? Anyway, Reeves is a little bit of trouble. Troll trap over on him. A little bit of support coming in as well, but yeah, it's going to be Enigma rotating over.
And the last Hadouken!
He was looking for it, man. But just a little bit too late.
Look at how low Mantis is. Jesus. Gorok, he's getting complete free farm in this lane because the Faceless Void hasn't been in the lane. So Gorok is going to be extremely happy with where he's at. It was worth the sacrifice, I think, to have the Enchantress be basically not farming up at all and also end up feeding away a kill to the Faceless Void. It's all worth it because the Illweaver is getting a free farm lane.
Okay, maybe I've turned on directed camera.
What?
No, it's not that, because, no.
You're not in Dota TV.
Yeah, there's no Dota TV, but there was meant to be a new change which would allow you to do some extra things like that.
Gotcha.
Goddamn's actually getting himself away. And Reeves
is going to go down.
Yep, there, maybe. Well, they're going to turn around. The Batrider does die on a different lane in the meantime, up on the top lane, but it's on the bottom lane. Well, they keep trying to go over here, over on the Weaver as well as over on the Enchantress, yep. But it was... Well, they're coming back in again. They're looking for the Enigma. Commitment with the Shadow Blast. And now, goddamn, go for the body block. Just to slow down Garsha. Malibuson's going to buy a little bit more space, but Gorok is now going to go in deeper. Mantis is looking for a kill on goddamn, but won't have enough. Gorok, he's got Shikuchi off cooldown in 1 second time, and goddamn turned around to this fight. Reeves
got enchant.
Came back out again. Yep, there's your enchant. Slowing down Reeves. Running him through, looking for Shikuchi. General attack still on cooldown for the moment, while Mantis chasing down goddamn. There's your leap up. Is he going to get himself a time lock on this one? No joy.
That was almost the Shadow Shaman dying twice in basically 30 seconds. He really should have gone down. They made a slight misplay with the Weaver there. He actually clicked the wrong side of the trees and ended up losing a bit of time that would have given him the auto attacks necessary to kill the Shadow Shaman there. But that was a super successful fight for KPG. And we haven't even looked at some of the other lanes, which should be going even better than the bottom lane. Slark versus the Batrider is a fine matchup. He's even got an Earthshaker backing him up. So that should be a fairly easy lane. And then the mid matchup is just a spam war. Like, it's Razor, who is a strong lane dominating hero, but Death Prophet is the ultimate survivor up against anything. Right, because she just sits back and spams Crypt Swarm. She's like a ranged form DK at this point.
Batrider trying to come in. Actually, Regeneration Rune was still able to get to the Death Prophet at that point, and they're chasing it down, looking for that a drain of damage, but it's so low on levels.
Yeah,
it had
early,
to be level one.
The early phase boots there is really what protected Jett. He's got Witchcraft, which gives him 15% movement speed, and then Phase Shift as well. No one can keep up with that.
People are spamming at me directed camera on the top right, but guys, not that a TV. This thing does nothing for me. Absolutely nothing for me. It's literally just it's flicking me back.
Toby, why you break?
I don't know.
Why you break?
I don't know if it's actually if it's trying to do it all automatically, if there was a button, because there is meant to be something that's meant to help with this. Somebody who's tuning in right now who has me on Skype, send me a message about what the hell is broken. Someone's going to be out there that can help. I don't know what's broken in Dota 2. Anyway, sorry. I'm being really put off by this. My apologies.
That's quite all right. We're going to see an early mech for the Razor. Not a big surprise there. Faceless Void may be going for a Hand of Midas. He does have the Gloves of Haste.
Hey,
this would be a recovery
Cap,
Hand of Midas.
Can you click on a different hero?
Sure.
It's your damn perspective!
What? Nice.
It's your perspective! Whatever nice. You click on, I am going to! How is this even happen? Wait, hang on. Cap, you are now cameraman.
No, I'm not.
You're not? Okay, no,
I'm looking at the lane right now. It's definitely not the cameraman.
My camera's locked! I can't move it! Now I can move it! We're down, there goes your Weaver. The Enchantress on the run, there's a leap directly after him at the moment, and maybe with the Firefly, there's your Lasso, holding goddamn in position. And that's going to be him on the sidelines as well. A double kill coming out for Waterfucker. And I rely on you, Cap, to be my clicker.
It's funny because I don't usually spend that much time clicking.
Fissure,
as
top
much.
Lane is going to be over. Whoa! On Reeves. Hey!
Right.
The pounce oh went that away. Now Shackles holding the Earthshaker in position, but it's not going to be enough to get the kill. How is that even possible?
I don't know.
Did you click cameraman or something? Even then, that shouldn't change it around.
No, because you saw
Enigma walks in nice and close, just staring at him at the moment because he can't kill off the invisible Slark. And now he's got pounce off cooldown, leaps into the tree lines, midnight pulse. They can see him, but where's the stun? There's just the basic damage from the Enigma as well as Waterfucker.
Who gets midnight pulse?
Bottom lane.
Three level six.
The Krob actually manages to kill the Faceless Void. We got a DC out from the Razor. Void died just behind the tier one tower down here for the Krob ulti as he ran through the trees with Gorik.
Slark is probably like, sweet, I'm home free. I just pounced away from the Razor. He already used his big nuke. And somehow, we've got Enigma with Midnight Pulse at pre-level 5, which I'm presuming he was doing some shenanigans. Yes, that's why. If you look over to where I'm drawing on the map, which you can't see, but if you look over to my screen.
I can...
Radiant Hard Camp.
Okay.
A safe one.
Somehow, I've hit a button which is... No. Try and move the screen.
I'm moving Toby's mouse for him.
No.
Wow.
No. Really see, you anywhere. Don't bloody believe me. Where is the trust level here? I literally cannot move my screen right now.
It's so weird.
Okay, for some reason, my L button, which is funny enough, the button which I bound back at Valve.
Yeah.
Which
that.
Is meant to actually hook into like the directed cam. But it's not meant to take over your clicks.
Wait,
if I can hit L, can I click on the heroes I want to click on? No, I can't. I just lock my screen perspective.
Anyway, can you move to where?
Yes, I can. I can move to here.
That is what
camps here.
So, because I was making all this fuss about Midnight Pulse, that is what Enigma was using the Midnight Pulse for.
To
double
clean
stack
up the trees. So
double
stack.
Stack.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, that's good. Sorry, I'm feeling really stressed. I need a moment.
Dobie's feeling stressed. People are either flaming me or the Enigma for my night pulse. But now we know why.
I'm being controlled by you. I don't like this. I don't like this.
It's alright, accept it, Toby.
I can't accept it. I will not refuse. I refuse to accept it.
By the way, Enigma, at
Someone
level 6.
Push the button.
At level 6, he used a level to get Malphus. To level 2.
Okay. That's little alt.
I'm 99% sure. That, like, I'm level 5. I saw him 1-3-1.
Had to be a misclick.
I mean, maybe I'm seeing things. Maybe I'm seeing things, and he actually did level Midnight Pulse at level 6 just to be able to reveal the trees, but I'm 99% sure I saw 1-3-1 build on him at level 5.
If
I need to go back in time.
Well, I can't do that, unfortunately, for you.
Why aren't
man.
We casting from Dota TV,
well,
Toby?
Presumably with the Gigabyte motherboard, it has like the DeLorean symbols on it, so maybe we can actually go back in time.
Screw up something in a cast?
That's it. To the DeLorean!
The G1 Sniper Z97, now with time-lapse!
Wait, did I even buy it? I don't remember. Would I buy it again? I don't know. I time-lapse. I don't remember what I did. Well, I can't remember my decisions.
You buy it. I regret this immediately. Time lapse. You buy it again.
And funnily enough, Infinite I don't regret loop. It the second time around. What's going on here? I think I was influenced by an outside source. Just saying. All right. So,
you ever look at Batrider's portrait when he's got this bandana deal? I just feel like he's some sort of combination of something from Naruto and Dragon Ball Z at the same time. Like, his hair looks like he's going Super Saiyan, but he's also got like that bandana. I'm not a Naruto reader, watcher.
Especially when you said that he's going Super Saiyan with a Naruto bandana. Did you just say that?
I just said the combination.
Did you just say that?
I just said Dragon Ball Z too, Toby.
Really? So what, you're trying to blend Dragon Ball Z and Naruto?
You don't listen to me. I said it was a combination of Naruto and Dragon Ball Z. His hair is going Super Saiyan, but he's got up a Naruto bandana. Damn it all the hell. We're having issues tonight.
We are. We are, especially when you start trying to blend anime. Then the
whatever, man.
That's a greater issue. Like, as far as like my camera issues right now, with the fact that you control everything that's currently displaying in my HUD, like that's one small problem. the other major problem is still going to be the fact that you're trying to blend Naruto
with Dragon Ball
with
Z.
Dragon Ball Z.
What's wrong with that?
Sorry, man.
Which one are you upset about?
You can't go sexy spirit bomb. I'm just saying right now. Dire's
bottom tower. I'm sorry, are you more upset that I'm putting Naruto with Dragon Ball Z or Dragon Ball Z with Naruto?
I kind of hold Dragon Ball Z a little bit higher than I do Naruto.
Oh, that's probably good.
Because Naruto just had way too many freaking fillers.
But I don't.
Yeah, but Naruto has Toby, so it's hard to debate that one, really.
What?
I don't know why I keep trying to click on things. It's very, very unnatural. Yeah, so Batrider's doing a little bit of flash farming here inside the jungle. So bring up the monies for him.
It's 1,500 for him. He's almost got a blink dagger.
Awesome.
I revealed that 10 seconds ago, Toby.
I'm sorry right now. I'm always looking at fantasy points, which is not a great thing. Seems I can. I still control my graph display on the left side. That's still under my power.
Mecarino is up for the Razor.
Awesome.
Yeah. So that's good.
All right. So Weaver's having a really freaking great time down here on the bottom lane. He's got all the space in the world as this Weaver. He's looking down at a tier 2 tower. Manus is too scared to go in, which I can't believe I'm saying when you've got... It's a chrono void. Like, you have a chronosphere. You shouldn't be fearful of anything. And now, okay, there goes your chrono. They've got to try and get this last two on. He's moving in front, had to go to the very edge. Now, time lift's already being used. Shikuchi's still available, and there's a lot of support coming in now from the Enchantress. A lot of abilities being expanded. Menace has to jump himself away. The hoof stomps over on the Batrider, and now the bugs are coming in as well. They got a secondary stun over there. So Menace actually got locked in, and the Batrider's going to go down here. Gorik, too much commitment, however, with Wotafuck arriving with a plasma field, able to lock him down. And Fisher, okay, now Wotafuck is in a bad position. Eye of the Storm or not, he's locked in with Exorcism. Maybe with the mech they have enough damage to actually know life points they have life, but nope, the Impetus is out from goddamn. One more Crypt Swarm, the Impetus, he jumps out of it. No,
what?
It actually, okay,
it followed
him. Okay, Impetus, from me, the animation stopped here, but he died
there.
Over here as well. Somehow.
Game's broken.
Yes.
Spectator view and in just regular playing mode. That there's no way that Impetus should.
You know what this reminds me of? We walked through three people out there that were involved in the age of WOD TV. If you're involved during that period, remember what would happen when the host would pause the game. That's what I'm talking about. It would desync out the replay. So
people
would die for no apparent reason, and abilities would just, like, randomly the hero would trigger an ability and it goes in no direction whatsoever and he gets a kill on air. And it's like, what the hell's going on? We're not back at that level yet. We might be getting closer. But yeah, KPG, really good fight for them on the bottom lane. They turn around both the chrono and they take the tier 2 tower. They get a lot of big kills up, and they don't lose any of their primary heroes either, because when you look at it, like, what have you lost? Like, Void's gone down twice. Batrider, Mr. what was meant to be, what, 10-minute blink dagger? He's actually died twice as well. And this Shadow Shaman has been the beating horse. He's 0-4 at the moment. Now they're gonna try and keep the battle going on the middle lane, and KPG make the wise decision. They back themselves up because they still had the free farming hero who's not involved in any engagements, Slark, over on the top lane.
Who's gonna be probably picking up a blink dagger of his own. I think this is a good game for blink dagger. Shadowblade is not worth it, I would say, up against and Enigma, as well as the Faceless Void. You've got two big ultimates that counter Slark really well, so he needs to pick up the more offensive choice of Blink Dagger.
Oh. I'm wondering how long. Actually, really with KPG, if they only have an Enchantress, I'm wondering if they try and go for Roshan sometime shortly as well. Because with Untouchable, you could just take Roshan. Oh, Void Chrono. Caught the Weaver. There's no follow-up. This Chrono is for nothing, because it's still... Hey, look. Time-lapse. Malibu Stone, Sentry Ward. Black he's hole? Out of range Black of Sentry hole? Ward. Not using it yet. He's on the edge of it. Black...
There you go.
Weaver locked in. Maybe there's enough damage. Shackles as well. That 100% guarantees he stays in position. But in middle lane, Wanafucker is currently dying to Krob ulti. And a four-man push will bring down the Tier 1 tower as well. Weaver for a Razor and a Tier 1 tower, worth it any day for the trade for KPG. And they're going in deeper. That Blink Dagger leash was perfectly done onto the Batrider.
Artis is going to go down. Oh, the heal?
Yep. Nice. There's sprites that were used by the Enchantress. We had this bug actually earlier tonight as well, where the sprites aren't visible.
Yep.
They're definitely healing, they're just not visible on the map.
Yeah, Valve broke a lot.
I don't, yeah.
For TI4.
But they didn't even break it during TI4, because all this stuff was working during TI4. It's just something that's like gone off. That water on the service thing from last night. Hotfix. Crap. We broke everything else. Who's here? Now they're on holidays after TI.
Time to go to Hawaii again.
I don't know. I don't know. When I don't see, that can't hurt me.
What?
That's what they said when I watched scary movies.
Okay.
I'm just telling you right now, man. What you can't see, you can bloody hear, and that'll still make you fall off the couch, bump your head against the freaking table, and that hurts, man. And I didn't see it, and it still hurt me. I was lied to.
For those of you guys who don't know, Toby is almost Blitz level of pansy when it comes to horror movies.
It's true. I can't deal with them. Okay. I'm not a fan. Dude, I still have troubles with Demolition Man. I know, because when he put the pen into the eyeball, oh my god, I can't do that. Anything touching my eye, I'm just like freaking out. I can't do it, man. I just can't do it.
Have you seen Evil Dead?
I have not seen Evil Dead, just judging by the title name. Now, double TP is coming in. Chrono, it goes on the Slark, and they're going to drain out his damage right now. Fissure trying to buy some space with a triple stun. Panrider also coming in, but it's the Krob ulti. Exorcism's going to do some heavy work, but Void jumping down. Jet, you're in fire. You will not survive when you try and walk that, but the Echo Slam from the Earthshaker, still not enough. What a fucker just turns the parts of field. Maybe the Weaver. He's still got time lapse, and boom, he's out. He should be able to pick off Reaves here at least. Shikuchi available, has to run himself away at the moment. Bottle charges, two available, plasma field off to the side. So it's currently Razor versus Weaver. Mano a mano. Just you and me and the huge space between top lane and mid.
Or Gorik is going to go ahead and back away from that one. I think he's lucky enough just to be able to even out that team fight and make it a 4 for 4.
Look at his net worth. He's at 8,000 net worth, dude. This guy's about to pick up his Lincoln Sphere.
Yeah. Yeah, they still have really good controlling abilities. Again, the Black Hole as well as the Chronosphere are perfect up against the Slark and the Weaver. So I'm still concerned because X Game did a great job countering them. However, it was at the cost of their lanes. And that's why KPG have been able to take such an early lane, laning advantage, and build a rather large gold lead. I mean, you take a look at that gold graph. It is really, really far down there.
Not too shabby, man.
Not too shabby.
It really isn't too shabby. Even the experience is coming with them. It's about 5,000 on the experience. Not to mention just the 9K gold you're talking about.
Yeah, even your lowest hero on the net worth board right now, Earthshaker, 3,600. He's going to have a Blink Dagger before 20 minutes. For support, that's extremely good timing. Especially if you go Arcane Boots first. So all in all, KPG have a huge gold lead, and it's very well spread, and they have great heroes to be able to take advantage of that. I mean, just look at the Enchantress, who's going to have an Aghanim's in a short amount of time.
Here you go with the Enchantress, too. This is what I was talking about with the Untouchable. Trigger the Krob ulti of the Enchantress, take that. She's got 3 points up in the Untouchable. So this is easiest, like, this is easiest pie. And once they take out the Roshan, he's already half-life. They went up the Krob ulti for the fight in the bottom lane. But having an Aegis the Immortal into the hands of the Weaver may just be all they really require. And because when Roshan goes down too, he'll be able to buy first Lincoln Sphere and now grab the Aegis the Immortal.
Oh no, Shadow Shaman!
Did he just miss with all that Serpent Wards up against the Slark?
Serpent Wards hit Slark twice in a row.
Like, is Slark had to hit the tower twice, and the wards hit him, hit the Slark twice. So he had two different opportunities to be able to take the tower. And Artist just goes ahead and denies it.
Whoops. And that's a lot of money being lost for Ice Gaming, considering they're losing a lot of map control right now.
Considering they gave up Roshan in order to claim that tower.
Yeah, they can't allow for that kind of stuff. Like, they need to be able to get a better trade off than that. Well, for now, looks like Slark and Enchantress.
Big item pickups for them. BKB is going to be up soon for the Razor, though. Mantis is also going to be grabbing a Mask of Madness as soon as he can, but he's so far behind, it's not going to come up anytime soon. And a straight BKB for the Enigma.
Not too shabby, man. Not too shabby. I kind of still would have preferred to see a Blink Dagger coming out from him. Just this early on, I just got a feeling like his BKB won't protect him enough from the damage output, which is going to be coming the way from the Weaver.
Yeah, he's only got two abilities he has to worry about. Unfortunately, both of those heroes are going to be very far back. It's either the Death Prophet with the Silence or the Earthshaker Fisher. So yep. I could get down with a Blink Dagger, but I think it's the wiser choice to go straight BKB because even though there are only two abilities to stop you, chances are one of those heroes, especially the Earthshaker who now has a Blink Dagger, is not going to be caught in that black hole, and he will stop you immediately.
A lot of TPs coming out towards that top lane. That aggressive Observer Ward, there's your Fissure. Over towards the Batrider, has to go into Firefly. The Weaver Bug's trying to stick with him, but he'll blink himself away to safety. And the TP out from Wadafaka will be in enough time that he's also home and hosed. But Slark then again, this Slark, yeah, he's trying to keep up with him. The Blink Dagger on cooldown, though, he walked through the fire.
Yeah, he could have blinked, but he ended up walking through the fire
instead. Mid-tower.
Instead.
Okay, to dial. Master Open Wars attacking off to the side. Twitching.
Oh my god. Shadow Shaman. You're losing it, buddy.
Whoops.
Reeves.
That's not Gucci.
Reeves.
Yep.
Sun's fan is disappointed.
Little bit of problems coming out from the He was even twitching the wards. Like, you could see him doing it. He was actively going, I will not miss this last hit. I will not miss... I missed this last hit. And it's also a different Reeves if anyone was really worried about that. It's actually
that
not the Reeves
comes up
from
in chat all the time.
Yes, it's not Dota Cinema Reeves. It's a different Reeves.
I believe Reeves spells his name with an A. Could be wrong.
I don't know. I've never looked that closely at his name.
I believe it's R-E-A.
I'm not a person who, as speaking as a audio commentator, I'm not a person that's a student of the written word.
BKB. Mask of Madness.
Now there's something completely legitimately about the game.
Another BKB. Four big item pickups for X Game. Four items that actually change a lot in the next team fight.
But at the same time, like, in the next team fight, you got double Lincoln Spheres over on the two calls from KPG.
Yeah.
Like, what are you really going to be doing? Like, well done with the Observer Ward. Instantly counted out. How are you supposed to initiate? Batrider cannot initiate. Void Chrono is the only thing that's going to make it happen here. And even then, if Urshaker keeps his distance with a good Fissure, he can keep him out. Now, Blink Lasso, he goes on one of the guys who doesn't have it. Void Chrono, she dragged him out. Urshaker's still got the Echo Slam off, so a large amount of damage to Mantis as well as to the Batrider, and now they're going in deeper. It's just the Slark leaving for a kill. Black Hole catching out the Weaver, catching out the Slark Flame Break, almost bouncing him out, but look at that Impetus damage. Mantis is toast up the hill.
Oh,
another one as well. Man, this Enchantress is shredding them.
God damn, it's going ham.
Man, that range he's got with the Aghanim's upgrade, it's a 21-minute Aghanim set to Enchantress. Come on!
Yep, he's soon going to have a 4-staff, so that just makes it probably... I mean, I would go for a 4-staff. It's usually the go-to item for an Enchantress. He just lob a shot, turn around, 4-staff himself away, do like 500 damage with one hit.
And they're going to keep the pressure on here, KPG. They take a big fight. And they move themselves around now into different lanes. So it's going to be the tier 2 tower on the top lane. And next game, they can't fight this. Even if Batrider has it in his mind to come up here and fight this, it's not going to work. He's already basically burnt out most of his Firefly. In fact, now it's completely gone. He's got no lasso available. In fact, there's only one ultimate available for X game, and that's with the respawning Razor. Who's running himself out here on the bottom lane. But he's got Weaver with now a Demon Edge behind him.
Yep, soon to be MKB for him.
Surprised he's not going for Desolator.
Yeah, I'm a little bit surprised too, seeing as we're not going to see any evasion anytime soon. And obviously it doesn't do anything against Backtrack. Backtrack is its own special kind of evasion.
Hey, Cap, can you do one quick thing?
No. No, I won't click on the hero you want me to click
on. No, reconnect back into the game for me.
What?
Because it may fix my bug.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
Toby's getting desperate now.
Okay, no, that's not working. You've got to close the entire game. Well, hello, bottom lane. There's your jump in. Maybe it will be enough. Weaver being shackled up, and he's going to go down with a Firefly right on top of him.
You want me to actually close my game entirely?
Yeah, I think you've actually got to if this bug's going to ever fix. Blink up by the Slark. For some reason now, I'm wondering, we got no one else here in the broadcast channel, but the clicks are still moving through. Actually, what is it? I can box highlight. I can box highlight, but that's it. I don't think I can actually... Hey! No. Yeah, I can't click. Okay, Volvo, dev forums. We need to go to dev forums. But while you're not here, I can at least box select. So that works for me. Bottom lane, blink down. There's Waterfucker. And Impedistam is already going to start. And the BKB will protect him. This is not the way he really wanted to be triggering off his BKB. Goes all the way back to base. And that was his 9-second charge now on the sidelines. And how long have we got to next Roshan? Like, it's a minute and a half until the spawn potential time is there.
I'd provide you analysis, Toby, but I'm not allowed in the game.
Hey,
apparently. All right, I'm back. Can you still?
Batrider's in a little bit of trouble.
Yeah, he's got four stuff.
He's good. Yeah, he's four stuff back down again. But now the D ward is now going on.
It's back to me again.
It's back to you again.
It's back to me again.
All right, wonderful.
Just gonna have to accept it.
I will accept what's going on then.
Double damage. Haste for the Weaver, and double damage for the Slug.
Well, Slark's going to find someone too. It's Mandus over on the tree line. He time walks himself away and the Enigma TP's out almost instantly after. And then Slark's almost finished up his Skadi as well.
Yeah, you know, it's really nice that Chronosphere does reveal Slark when he uses Shadow Dance. But when Slark has so many stats over you, like he's going to have a Skadi, so he's going to be really tanky, faces Void meanwhile, still has that same old Mask of Madness that he picked up about 15 minutes in. So you're going to have some serious issues. I don't think they'll really ever be able to burst down the Slark unless they get a Chronosphere, start focusing him down, and then they get a black hole after the Chronosphere fades.
Roshan, I want to see the timing on it. I missed the clock when it came up before, so with my panicking kind of thing. So how long have we got? Roshan, give us the countdown. Okay, 1.5 minutes. That's actually a really long time for KPG to just keep delaying this one out. Like, the major arms are already going to arrive in a moment. Like, the Slark with his double ultimate orb, so Skadi just a hop, skip, and a jump away. Weaver, Monkey King Bar's not going to be far off either. And you've already got your double Blink Daggers over on the Earthshaker with the Blink Dagger.
On the opposite side, BKB was finished up on the Enigma. Ghost Scepter now being grabbed by the Batrider. Eventually, Faces Void will get something. I don't know, maybe you pick up a Chrysalis, I guess? I don't know, you need some sort of damage-dealing item that only costs about 3,000 gold, because you are not going to have very much more time. There's a 5-man Death March coming through the bottom lane, and there's no Tier 2. So KPG have decided they're going to either take Arax or end the game with this push. They may wait for Roshan, but I think they're actually going to pick up Roshan and go back down to bottom.
Yeah, it looks like they are too. The Courier is just sitting on top of the Rosh Pit at the moment, waiting for the timer for KPG. So they got 20 more seconds to wait for that one. The Courier's fine, just watching for that. As we do have Waterfucker now. Well, Bugs are coming up to him. He's going to back himself out. But the pink still came out. Just saying, be very, very mindful of this. But Roshan's only like 2 seconds away from spawn time. And Courier, don't walk away right now. This is your time to be effective. At the same time, Weaver is TPing top. They see Roshan spawn. In fact, they triple TP up here. So they're going to force it back off the top lane and then move down to Roshan.
Oh, Death Prophet. Okay, good. I was almost expecting them to try and go for the Death Prophet kill there somehow, but it's just, it's X Game need a pickoff really badly, so I'm kind of surprised they're not trying to go for it with the Batrider, but at the same time, KPG are giving them little room to find pickoffs. Because inevitably, like, it's fine if X Game want to play static and draw this game out, but at a certain point, you can see the train coming.
Yeah. Like KPG are going to get Roshan. They're going to get the Aegis, in which case the death push is going to come. So you can't just sit back and let them get that because there's no items you're going to get that is going to change your fate. They, like, Faces Ward got a Maelstrom. So he didn't go for the Crystallis. Instead, he went for the attack speed item. I like Maelstrom better than Crystallis, so I'm down with that. But when it comes down to it, it's just not enough.
Now give him some time. Give him some time, and maybe he can catch up to all of this while Batrider is hiding himself up here on the tree line. The KPG, it really does feel like they have all the control this game. With 14,000 gold, with 9,000 experience, with Weaver getting completely out of control, Death Prophet, you're highlighting right now with so much money.
Oh, there it is.
And, well, initiation, but is it really going to be enough follow-up? Echo Slam with the Totem Stomp trying to hold him there. Weaver had to time-lapse himself out of that one, and now he's just going to chase down the Batrider, and the Slark pouncing into Enchantress, kill-securing with the Impetus. So it becomes a Batrider for an Earthshaker trade-off. Normally, maybe you think you're okay when you're that far behind, but you're still feeding the Enchantress. The Enchantress built a Mask of Madness to go with her Aghanim's upgraded Impetus. While bottom lane, jump in, Chrono. Now, this time, Madness has no extra follow-up. He needs as many time-locks as he can possibly get, and then your Black Hole to hold Jet in position. Hatred towards Krom is high tonight.
That wasn't even necessary, I would say. The Midnight Pulse was actually doing a ton of work because Krob has almost finished up a full heart. So that 7% tick damage from the Midnight Pulse, I think, was enough to ensure that kill. But he wanted to make sure there was no way Death Prophet could get out.
A lot of movement coming towards bottom lane now from X Game. Do they really want to try and force this one? What a fucker. Fisher,
oh,
he is way too far out of position. And now Mask of Madness turns on, taking the damage. The sprites will go, but it means Gorek's got all the space in the world. And they just turn. It's Impetus damage and protect. How much physical DPS have they got? Not enough.
Oh, wow.
Back to base in time.
I am shocked he actually lived through that. That was... I mean, pop the BKB there was some serious cojones. I thought he was just going to go down.
I think it was just, well, you're just trying to stop the Impetus, right?
Yeah, he was just stopping the Impetus damage, which was good. I just didn't think, I thought the Weaver had enough damage to be able to just right-click him down, so.
Well, Weaver still didn't finish the Monkey King bar by that point, so. Yeah. A little bit more difficult. But that is coming in on the courier at the moment, so life will be a little bit easier for him now.
Another 2K for the Faceless Void, so he can get another small item before this death push.
I think APG
in.
Are going to go here. Like, yeah, the Echo Slams are cooldown to 15 seconds time. You got no Black Hole, you got no Chrono for the moment. Mass Open Wars might be up as well as Eye of the Storm, but like, Manus is a long way out of position, too. He's pushing the mid tier 2 tower at the moment, and already we've breached High Crown. What a fucker! Well, with no BKB, he was 7 seconds off having that off cooldown again. He'll go down, instantly buys back. So what do you got? You're going to raise a death to buy back, as well as for a tier 2 tower in the middle lane. You got a Lingard Sphere protection, and wow, a good jump in by PSM. And Impetus damage again. Shaman's on the sideline. The Urshaker may die right now, but the damage going into what a fuck with his BKB or not. Good Chrono, actually, catching three heroes here. At the same time, though, Krob's just sitting on the back with that Exorcism, doing some decent work, but it's not enough to really threaten them up. And maybe the Slark, okay, whoa, not enough. Not enough life points to survive through all of that one. Even with the 15 wand charge, decides not to use them. An Exorcism Krob will back herself back out again. And they only took off half of the tier 3 tower. I really thought KPG had a better team fight than that.
Yeah, the Death Prophet, half the ultimate was used to try and deal damage to people. They did a massive overextension there. Big play from the Faces Void with that 3-man Chronosphere is what ensured that they didn't lose the game right there. But KPG also overextended themselves. They had plenty of time to go, okay, they bought back, let's just try and poke at the tower. Instead, they fully committed, despite the fact that they had already blown through a little bit, and tried to take a fight behind the tier 3 tower and end up going very sour for them. So they give up a good amount of room for X Game to make a recovery off of this one. That means Faces Void is now going to be able to finish up the Mjolnir, the full-out Mjolnir, before the next fight occurs.
It's just really nice for him. At the same time, though, without a big Chrono like he had before, that Mjolnir could do absolutely nothing during the team fights. He can just evaporate to the attacks from KPG. If KPG are able to focus fire like they should during the fights. But at the same time, they just buy themselves a little bit more space. So Enigma, 2.4k gold over on him as well. So he is on the way to getting what? Actually, what are we even looking at from him? Are we looking Refresher? Are we looking at what from?
Yeah, I was thinking about Refresher. I was also thinking about maybe Boots of Travel to try and take, because you're playing the defense game so much. Boots of Travel is good when you're having to play so much defense, because when you do finally win that one team fight, you can actually teleport out to one of the side lanes, hopefully.
They found someone. What a fucker. Fish out. The bug's already on top of him. So looking for the naked armor and this spamming impetus, hoping for some extra damage.
Wow.
But there was no Monkey King bar mini stun. So what a fucker's back to base.
So unfortunate, man. The RNG is just not there for the Weaver right now. It should have been such a simple, easy pickoff. We're also going to have Artis, who's going to be going for Basher. Not a big surprise for him. Yule Scepter was finished up on the Batrider. We have Jet, who's probably going to be going Ashivas with this plate mail. It was just a value plate mail for earlier to deal with the Faceless Void's physical damage inside of Chronosphere, but he will probably now turn that into Ashivas. Maybe an AC.
Man,
you're
smoke
so
movement.
Far ahead, you could go for it.
Top lane, then walking around the bugs. Currently, if I'm wrong though, the bugs won't latch you while you smoked.
No, they will not.
Yeah, so they didn't actually have to evade that at all.
Radiant's top tower.
But they definitely know Weaver's enabled, especially when the Observer was right next to him. Hey, hello! Blink black hole, but they need a follow up stun, and that's the reason why Regis there, but they didn't trigger the linkage in time!
They did not. So a couple things. What a fucka used Static Link, but he didn't click on the hero. He clicked on the ground. Bottom lane. Mantis.
Well, that's a nice chrono for him, but it's not enough to get any kind of damage out. And, well, Batrider wants to escape from this one. He actually pushed the slug closer towards him. And now, locked. Oh! He blinks away at the same time the slug blinks up.
Well, this is beautiful. What a fucka is now going to be able to lay down some damage on the tier 2. They didn't lose anybody, and they're going to claim a tier 2 in exchange.
It looked like a catastrophe after like that like the bit of a balls up on the top lane.
Backdoor
chrono on bottom. Oh, true. Yeah, there's no creep wave, is there?
Yeah.
And look at Slark. He's coming up. He's going to try and find the killer. And what a fucker blinks up. And, well, there's already the leash, but there's no follow up stun. And he doesn't own one. Not until he gets that basher up and running. And it is a basher for him, isn't it?
Yes. For the Slark, 100%.
Yeah.
I mean, wonderful. You could go an MKB, but again,
he's got the Bell of Giant Strength in his stash, so yeah. It's gonna be.
Basher is super good for Slark because the Mega Basher that you end up with the Abyssal, it gives you a needed amount of damage because when you start out the team fight, you don't hit that hard. As you start stealing away more and more stats, you obviously become more and more of a heavy hitter.
Yep.
But the Abyssal is really what gives you your jump start into damage. And it's just another good additional holding ability.
Man, XKM's going to really try and find something to do in this game at the moment. They actually came back a lot of the experience. They repaired what was a 11,000 deficit and managed to pull it back to 4,000, almost 2,000 at one point during those last couple of engagements. But they're still dealing with a really, really fat crop as well as Weaver. Like, you look at the net worth right there, and that's where the problem is. The top three belong to KPG.
Yeah, really what it comes down to is X Game are staving off what should have been a Rakdos advantage for KPG by now.
Yes.
So they're doing a good job. The Faceless Void still needs a lot more time, I would say. He needs at least one big luxury item. He's got 3,300 gold, so he's another 3,000 gold from getting something like a Butterfly or even just straight out Daedalus if he wants to go that route.
It's one little Enigma conversion. Scouting out the pip. It's only another 10, 20 seconds until Roshan's going to be spawning himself up. At the same time, the Basher has just been purchased. Unfortunately for the Slark, the Courier's going to go all the way back to base before he can get it back out to himself. But Roshan is literally seconds away. At the same time, big item coming in for Razor. Aghanim Scepter will now be completed up for him. That Weaver that you just flashed as well, he's just picked up a Reaver. So we got Aghanim Scepter as well as Reaver.
He needs to make sure he can survive through the Chronosphere initiation.
Yep.
At the very least, he needs to be able to force out two of the big ultimates, and hopefully the Slark will be able to carry through if he ends up dying.
Well, maybe I was reading my timer wrong. Whoa. Oh, hello, middle lane. That's a lot of overcommittal, but then again, with Shadow Blade, he had with the Shadow Dance, he had enough to get himself back out this one, and now the Chrono is able to bring him down too. But BKB Enigma, he Black Holes. How the hell did he reach the enchanters on that one? Now Jed's going to come in too with his own ultimate. They're triggering the Linger Sphere off from him, moving over towards Goddamn. It's 3-for-2 at the moment, trying to lock down Jed and bring him down and get rid of this damn Exorcism. Because the damage is still going to hurt him out. Weaver locked, able to time-lapse in time. He's away to safety. Jet Roshan's coming up. Not happy with everyone coming in, but Death Prophet getting a kill. Now the jump in. Roshan, Jet's trying to TP himself away! Oh. Couldn't make it in time. Faceless Boy will kill off the Death Prophet, but Weaver still here in the fight. Yule Scepter up and towards the air. Shikuchi's right underneath him. He's got Observers and Sentries here, so we can see where the movement's coming from the Batrider. Shikuchi again. Void, jump up. Time Lock is able to get it. It's that gem on top of him that's giving him the vision, or is it? Where's the gem on the Batrider? So all of KPG do go down at the end of the day, and Roshan is available, but Xscape don't have enough to bring him down.
Still though, that's Mantis getting a large amount of extra gold from being a part of that team fight. He just finished up his BKB, and he now has another 2,000 gold. So I like the BKB choice. I expected him to go full offense, but the BKB worked out wonders for him because he can kill the damn Enchantress, and the Enchantress is a big threat. But before the BKB, he couldn't actually target her whatsoever and just had to rely on everyone else to try and, you know, throw magic damage at her. But BKB was a very smart pickup.
Batrider finally came back and got rid of those Observer Wards and Sentry Wards that were on the bottom river. The ones he flew over the top off while still holding a gem. Mm-hmm. So he knew he was being watched the entire time. But if he backed up at all, they wouldn't have been able to kill off the Weaver. So he realized that too. But KPG, now they smoke in and they go in for Roshan. Slark blinked himself in to try and be involved in this one, and now, yeah, the Enchantress, untouchable, does the work for him. And they actually, okay, the pings come out there and they came out from the Enigma, ooh, saying, yo guys, check out Roshan. But he's so far away, they can't really do anything about this anyway. He actually TP'd all the way back to base.
Aghanim's is going to be the upgrade for Enigma. Forget about that Aghanim's upgrade all the time, but it is exceptionally good against some of these heroes that are going to be focusing on tanking
arrive
up.
Arrive in time? They can't arrive in time.
No.
After TPing back
think
to base
so.
And you Mantis? Get yourself all the way around, yeah, Mantis going to leap himself in here. There he goes, there you go. See, Maul, he's going to Chrono.
Oh,
he got four
so
heroes. It was a very quick jump out in the fissure. He's going to keep the Razor out. And there's some wards inside the pit as well. The last is going to go. Goddamn's already on the sidelines. And they've managed to get. Okay, this is going to be a big, big wipe right now. Made enough damage. There goes the Weaver. Aegis out. Echo Slam from PSM. Buys some space, but he also goes on the sidelines. Weaver's back alive with the help of the Aegis the Immortal. Batrider is currently trapped up on the side of a cliff. And Arsus had to run himself further north. Big fight, and that took too long for KPG. They came in, it was almost worth popping the Exorcism to kill off Roshan before X-Game was able to arrive, because they were doing that blind. Mm-hmm. There was no Observer Wards out for KPG.
And they knew they knew that there was probably a good amount of vision up because they gave away that gem, right?
So the jump, they're coming in right now. Arsus, maybe with Yule Scepter. They might be able to catch him out. Flame Break pushing him back. Dark Pact or not. The Midnight Pulse is down. He's in the tree line. Malibusun comes from good vision. They have nothing.
Lasso was just a second or two off cooldown.
Did Garsha have Malifus? He had to have Malifus.
Oh. No, he already used Malifus. He could have used Black Hole.
Dire's top tower has fallen.
Well, there goes Tier 2 tower on the top lane. S game. Maybe they can force the issue. Pushing up towards the higher ground. A little bit of damage from the Razor towards the Tier 3 tower will still be worth any kind of damage he does take now. They can just back up. They know they're being pressured out by the Weaver, so someone's going to come back for that one. But then again, Void, Leap, Chrono, got him. But then again, first hit goes over on towards the Creep. He's trying to get the right target over on the Weaver. And now with a Time Lock after it, Sentry Wards goes down. Heck, Shackles! He locked him in with the Time Locks and the Plasma Field. They get the kill. Okay. Okay, random generators helping him out a little bit there, but that's also Weaver getting caught out completely on the bottom lane.
KPG just falling apart now because the problem was X Game drafted themselves some good counter to KPG, but the result was they had a draft that lacked synergy, lacked a strong laning phase, and they were going to get crushed in the first 30 minutes. But since KPG were never able to close out the game or at least get a Rax advantage by now, they just fed so much time that the Faceless Void has made such a strong recovery. He is now full on late game Faceless Void mode now. Mm-hmm. And it's only going to get worse from here. Now, there's still a good chance that KPG can make the comeback, but it's...
It's entirely reliant on them being able to find the initiation and Slark locking down the Faceless Void, which is unlikely, right? The better initiation is on the side of X Game.
We have a Malkor War contender.
Nice.
He's a little far off at 11 more deaths, though, but X Game, when you look at the grass, dude, there wasn't a single point that X Game had an experience advantage in this game until the last couple of minutes. Yeah. And the gold graph, they still don't have the advantage, but it's coming up. Yeah. But maybe we can award a Malkor War during the Gigabyte Grand Final. That'd be nice. That'd be nice.
Yeah. Brush off the milk emoticon for Join Dota.
Yeah. I wonder how many people here in the chat actually have that. Because it's a nice emotion to display.
Enigma. Aghanims.
You need to be subscribed for that, though. He actually built an Aghanims?
He is going to.
Okay.
He's got 3,800 gold on him right now, so.
See, I'm not 100% sure about this. I know the upgrade's really nice, but like.
It's so good versus Death Prophet and Weaver, because Weaver builds a heart, right? Because you're trying to tank up against that. So
it's weird because you think like, oh, if it's like a centaur, if it's like a lone druid or something like that, like a hero with innately high life points, that'll be really good. But yeah, I kind of didn't actually take into account the fact that you've got still a lot of life points. It's 3k life points over on the Death Prophet.
Yeah, and then another 2k plus. I think he's sitting at like 2,200 on the Weaver. Mm. So that's 7% burn for the 4 seconds. That's 28% of your life points.
There's a bit of a movement coming out in this bottom lane. The sticky napalm, fire flying, creep wave, Bat Rider, able to get rid of the entire thing, which means this full creep wave is going to push in. There will be a catapult, attack. But yeah, Mana's going to take care of that pretty quickly. In fact, there she goes. And just beats down on top of the tower. Surprisingly not triggering off his Mask of Madness to make sure it's done very, very quickly.
Yeah, he probably figures he has nothing to fear since 20 seconds Dyer's on the Weaver. It's unlikely anybody's going to be going on him. So KBG are just split pushing, farming up. They're going to have an Abyssal for the Slark soon-ish. Chances are Enchantress is going to try and tank up. She's usually contender for a heart going into the super late game. Four staff for the Earthshaker eventually, but the big item pickups are going to be on the side of X Game, where you're going to see Whatafucka, who looks like he's going to be building into an Assault Kuras. I expected a heart for him, but an Assault Kuras is still a great tanking item. The Daedalus is going to be finished up by Mantis. We could even see Shadow Shaman probably start making his way towards an Aghanim Scepter as they start claiming more towers. And then the Aghanims for the Enigma as well. Again, like it just comes down to the fact that what was it, like probably 20 minutes ago, where X Game had a series of four items they were picking up all at the same time that were like game changers for them. And now you're going to have another round of items. And this is going to spell the doom for KPG, I think.
Unless KPG can get one hell of a team fight.
Yeah.
I don't even say team fight. If they can get one hell of an isolated fight, like when it's 5v2 straight away, you get those kills and the next game like stupidly runs in afterwards and steep feed a couple more kills, then you're going to be looking at a Rax advantage. And then KPG's straight back in on this one.
Yeah.
But they kind of need X Game to make a mistake, firstly by getting caught out, and secondly from overcommitting when they try and go for a counter initiation. That's what's going to happen for KPG right now.
Super, like, late game and super late game are about two different things primarily. I would say the carry power. So who has the stronger carry? Faceless Void is exceptional, but also initiation, right? So you have the necessary damage. The question is whether or not you're going to find the initiation. And X Game win on both grounds. They've got better initiation between the Faceless Void, the Bat Rider, as well as the Enigma. Those are three of the best late game initiators you could possibly have. And they've got the better damage with the Faceless Void, straight up. Like, he can just out-carry the Weaver. So, in general, it's unlikely for KPG to be able to win team fights.
Bat Rider, he found one. He found Goddamn. Drag him up on top of the hill. The Observable was scouting out perfectly. And now they're looking for a time lock over him. And they commit the Chrono. He got Jet in that one too. But the Fissure is actually blocking them out, forcing Mantis outside of his own Chrono. Trying to go on the Weaver, but he just time-lapsed out a lot of the damage. And maybe Jet's really feeling confident enough. Well, what the fuck is trying to take away his damage? PSM, oh, there's your black hole, holding down on the Slark. The Fissure will catch out three, but this still leaves the ES stranded inside the pit. Jet's got almost his full duration holding out. It's enough to finally bring down the Razor, but you've still got a Batrider with a Ghost that's protecting himself here. They need more damage out, and there's Void jumping in again. Oh, gets the no time lock on Jet, but now Manus is in way too deep. More Fissures flying out as well. You got Reeves out to safety with no mana whatsoever, but three heroes on the sideline. Now that's what KPG wanted. The fight was split in two.
Yeah. So there wasn't a good black hole. Like, it started out fine, which was Batrider finding a pickoff for them. Then they combined a decent Chronosphere that caught two heroes, but after the team fight split, it all went really bad for KPG because the worst possible thing happened. They did about 2,500 damage to the Death Prophet, and then he healed all up right as the Faceless Void went to leap on him and try and finish off the Death Prophet himself. So they didn't focus down the Death Prophet, yet they still laid enough damage into him that it was a huge loss.
This is the Rakdos advantage I was talking about after you take such a fight. Like, you can push into the Tier 3 tower, they just force the buyback out from the Batrider, which is kind of fair enough considering Slark also had to buy back, and they trigger the Lincoln Sphere, dragging the Krobos back. Earthshaker, good Fissure, holding him out, and they got Enigma, triggers out his own BKB at the moment, and Manus Chrono catches two Jets on the sideline of this one. He focuses on one, finish the Weaver! Okay, okay, let the Midnight Pulse try and do it. Oi, oi, oi. That's confidence in Midnight Pulse right there.
That was quite the shrill little squeak you let out there, Toby.
Well, he walked away. The Weaver was like on nothing.
I know. I agree.
And he just he walked away.
That's like some Havos level Faceless Void plays. I don't know if
we say Havos. Are we saying like it's Havos because Havos is that good? Is that what we're talking about right now?
Havos gets really, really greedy. It's a good idea in certain scenarios for you to try and leave a hero like that in order to move on to the next one, but Havos doesn't like, he gets super greedy with it. It leaves like one hero at 300 health, and it's a Chen, and Chen ends up popping his mech in his ultimate because he didn't finish him off.
Push is coming down middle lane. Goddamn's looking to come in through the rear, but if Batrider goes into a Firefly, he's in a lot more trouble. But Jet, ulti's off cooldown, he's gotta let it go. The Mass Urban Wards are up, but there's a jump in already. They trigger the Lincolns, there goes your ultimate, but Jet, he's in a lot of trouble. Lasso pulled back in almost the entire team, but the Echo Slam from PSM, trying to buy some space, but he's still down. What a fucker with his ultimate. Here's the Plasma Field, moved over towards the Earthshaker. They're just jumping themselves across the map. It's Manus who actually picks up a double kill as well. And they'll go up, high ground, four heroes on the sidelines, and what looked to be KPG knocking on the front door of X Game turns around to be completely the opposite, and Manus, okay, solo Chrono on goddamn, he just doesn't care. 67 seconds on the sidelines, and KPG may even be hovering their fingers over the G button, because this can easily rotate top, and they can take another Rakdos right now. If not, okay, they're coming bot instead.
They've got another Eye of the Storm, so it's easily them taking a second set of Rakdos and still going to be able to clean out the tier 4s. KPG would be left with probably a throne completely exposed if they do try and defend.
Yeah.
And that's just unlikely. So I would guess they're going to call GG here, but it just comes down to the fact that Compass Gaming had a really big advantage at one certain point, and they never closed out the game.
Oh, Batrider! He just had a double four-star down to reach him at that point. And there goes your Weaver. This is over. Yeah. This is over right now. There it is. GG. GG. X Game will take game number one, but this is, of course, a best of three grand final for the Gigawide Challenge. 1,500 euro goes to the winner. Not a bad day's work, but just only, well, 2 days of play. That's all they had to do for 2,000 euro prize pool. 500 goes to second place, so no matter what happens, everyone's a winner in this grand final.
Yeah, and most of these teams are just, they're changing their scrim time into, you know, tournament time. Yeah. So for them, they're still getting in all the practice they need, and they just so happen to be winning some money off of it. So well done by X Game, making a big comeback. I really didn't think they had it in them. I thought that the Face of Void was so shut down, and then Mask of Madness, right, is all he had. And next thing you know, he's got a Maelstrom. It's like, okay, that's never going to be enough. Then a Mjolnir, like, okay, you're getting there. And then he had the BKB and the Daedalus finished up, and it was just like, that is all he needs to be able to carry. So I think KPG just failed to be able to close out the game. But X Game also did a really good job holding on, and also they spread themselves out pretty well. I remember several times where the Faceless Void was just, you know, farming his jungle, the enemy jungle, split pushing where he could. He just was so shut down in the early game, yet he still made a good
mid-game recovery.
All right, man. Game two. After this break, we'll be back.